Alors, les micros, ils sont là. Je vais faire un petit speech avant.
La traduction vers l'espagnol.
Ah, c'est une bonne question.
Alors, attends, je leur donne, s'il te plaît, un morceau. Tu peux leur demander si...
Oui, il y a une des personnes de notre panel. One of our guests will speak in Spanish. So for those of you who doesn't understand Spanish, you should take translation headphones, headphones for translation into English or French. So, welcome to our last panel for this year. I wanted to take a minute to thank all participants for this year, all the people that help make this possible, especially the benevolent. And I wanted to thank the NIF to host us, our partner, the SRG-SSR, our technological partner, the XEM, the Art of VFX, our media partner, our partners like Best Western Premier, who accommodates our guests, Focal, Maxon, SideFX, Swiss-made VFX, Unity, and of course our supports, public supports, the Confederation, the State of Neuchâtel, the Ville of, the, of Neuchâtel, Pro Helvetia, Loterie Romande, and Haute École Arc Engineering. So this is for the standard speech. Now we're going to start Guerilla FX, and to host this panel, we have the luck to have Alexandre Poncet with us. Alexandre is a journalist, but also a director and a producer of documentaries, one of which, the Frankenstein Complex, you may see tonight and Thursday night. Tonight it's presented by Alexandre, and then he's going to rush to the concert. And on Thursday, he's not going to rush to the concert. He's going to stay, and he's going to have John Ho with him, the exceptional participation of John Ho, and they're going to answer Q&A with the audience after the screening of the Frankenstein Complex. I think I said everything. Is it okay? Okay. So we're going to start with a small presentation of every guest we have here. They're going to all come here and in 1 or 2 minutes and a few images present themselves, and then we're going to start the panel. Thank you.
Do you want me to explain maybe a little about the subject of the panel? Because in a perfect world, movies are always about a vision. And by definition, a vision is ambitious, but also intimate, personal. And it's sometimes very hard to find good money to achieve that vision. So we'll talk about how you create a personal vision without making too many sacrifices, how you play with the limitations you have and turn them into assets. So we have directors here, producers, VFX, SFX supervisors, designers, etc. And I think everyone will introduce themselves. We'll start with Talal.
Not working? Okay, it's working. Hi, my name is Talal Selhami. I'm a movie director, also producer. I come from France and Morocco. I did my first feature was Mirage, was shown here in Neuchâtel in 2011, and I'm here to talk about my feature Ashura. We're going to show you exclusive. Images of the movie no one has seen before. So this is a creature feature, a co-production between Morocco and France, and we were hopefully we will see the movie by the end of the year or maybe next year. So the subject is going to be heavy, I guess. So yeah, because the movie has a lot of visual effects. So what do we do? Do we show them?
What?
Yeah. Okay.
Allez, mon cœur, il est temps de dormir.
Notre lait, il parle du gros méchant monstre qui emmène tous les enfants.
Mais tu sais, mon cœur, il n'y a personne qui t'emmènera loin de nous.
T'as pas regardé dans mon placard.
Tu vois, il est vide, ton placard.
Racontez toujours cette histoire pour me faire peur. Derrière le champ, il y a une vieille maison. La maison des Français. Elle a été construite par des soldats français quand ils étaient là. Ils ont fait tellement de trucs horribles qu'un jour, quelque chose d'étrange est apparu.
C'est une affaire classée.
Papa! Tu vas rester avec nous ce soir?
Tu aurais pu passer un coup de fil pour prévenir.
C'est aussi chez toi.
C'est ta mère, tu ne parles pas comme ça.
On avait fait un pacte tous les trois. C'était dit qu'on n'oublierait jamais ce qui s'est passé ce jour-là.
On n'a rien oublié, on a été attaqué par un pervers.
C'était pas un pervers.
Se nourrit des enfants, de leur joie, de leur innocence. C'est de là qu'il tient sa puissance.
Tous les soirs d'un jour, ne supportant pas leur joie, il sort de son sommeil, affamé comme jamais. Une femme pour les manger, pour manger les enfants. Des enfants s'amusant, sombres et bocatantes.
Hello, everybody. My name is Isaac Ezban. I'm a film director from Mexico. I've made two future films. Mostly are science fiction. My first film was The Incident from 2014. It's a psychological science fiction film about characters trapped in illogical, endless spaces. We have on one hand the two brothers and a detective who stay locked on an infinite staircase, and a family traveling in the road that stay trapped on an infinite road, and they stay there for 35 years. And then my second film, Los Parecidos, The Similars, is showing right now here in NIF in the international competition. We had our last screening was yesterday night. I hope some of you were able to catch it. And it's also psychological science fiction, very much Twilight Zone inspired. It's about a bus station in the 60s where these eight people are waiting for the bus. There's a huge rain and they cannot get out because of the rain. And suddenly they discover they are becoming similar to one another in the faces and they don't know why. So these two films are, they have some special effects, some practical effects, but they are more psychological sci-fi where it's science fiction not relying so much on the effects. It's more relying more in the characters and in the story. And so that's why I'm not showing either of those films right now in this presentation on the trailer, because as this was about Guerilla FX, I wanted to show something more Guerilla FX, which I've done in my previous work. So we're going to show a segment of a short film, which I did before these two feature films when I was a student, that has more the vein of Guerilla SFX. I hope no one is offended by the short film we're going to show. Just to tell you the title, it's called Nasty Stuff. It's 30 minutes long, but we're just going to show 2 minutes. But if you want to find it with my name and the name Nasty Stuff, you can find it in Vimeo to watch it later.
Kriko Krakinski acababa de ver algo que le cambiaría la vida por completo. Pero la escena no había tenido otro efecto en él más que el de impresionarlo. Y entonces, algo inesperado ocurrió. Así como Krico Krakinski.
That's Herschel Gordon Lewis meets Brian Usner.
Yeah.
Okay. And Cronenberg.
Well, hi, I will talk for both of us. He's Simon Ratziel, and I'm Laura Sanchez Acosta. We are part of Daemonium, another film that is screening here in part of El Dorado selection. He is the designer and the designer of FX, special effects. I'm the producer, and also he is the creator of the story. And talking with Guerilla FX, how it's called, although what you are going to see now, this is a movie made in 5 years with only $16,000. So I don't want to spoil anything else. Our best description was an out of control science fiction, so I think that's everything I have to say.
My name is Victor Jaquier. I am a director and an illustrator. I directed four short films. Some were live action, some were stop motion animation. And now I am developing a feature project that will be full stop motion. It's a project I started to write 4 years ago, and I'm really now in the middle of the development process. It was supposed to be a short film, but I'm moving to the feature. I'm doing a feature with it now. And the sequence that you will see is the presentation sequence of the project that we show to our co-producers and investors. So it is really a collection of interviews where I am pitching the project, and a collection of concept arts. So.
Je m'appelle Victor Jaquier, je suis réalisateur et illustrateur. J'ai réalisé en 2011 un court-métrage avec Imagina Studio qui s'appelle Le Lac Noir. Après Le Lac Noir, j'ai souhaité continuer à travailler dans l'univers des contes. Et donc j'écris cette histoire qui est le parcours initiatique d'une petite fille qui a un nez en forme de tire-bouchon et qui s'appelle Manon. Un beau jour, ses parents lui annoncent qu'elle va devoir travailler pour gagner sa vie toute seule. Et donc elle va devoir partir dans une ville lointaine. Ça lui fait très peur parce qu'elle est sûre que dans cette ville, tout le monde va se moquer de son nez. En chemin pour cette ville, elle croise un petit être qui lui explique que dans une forêt interdite, on trouve des champignons qui peuvent rendre une forme normale à son nez. Et donc elle va céder à la tentation et suivre ce personnage dans une forêt magique de champignons.
I heard about the project going on a year ago now, I think. 2014, I believe, was when I first heard about it. And I immediately fell in love with it from a design standpoint, from the sort of initial design drawings to the sort of early mock-ups of the stop-motion figures as well, of the characters.
You chose well. You will be very happy here, I'm sure. Tomorrow, I will show you my domain.
I play a prince who has a massive castle in the middle of this mushroom forest. And the character for whom the story is told, Matilda, takes this path down into the mushroom forest and discovers a mushroom that can change her nose from being a corkscrew to a normal nose, so that she doesn't have to have this defect. And that allows her to stumble into this this sort of magical, massive castle where she meets the prince. And she's heard stories of there being an ogre in the forest, which initially was what made her afraid to go into the forest to begin with. And this polecat tells her, well, no, the prince slayed the ogre years and years ago. And so that story, the reveal of the truth of that story, happens in the context of the character.
Good evening. My name is Laurent-Paul Robert. I'm very happy to be here because I'm from Neuchâtel originally. And I started to work with computers mid-80s. And when I was here, I started to do graffitis. And for me, art was always something, because I have a lot of artists in my families. But the technology was always very interesting for me. And I always wanted to develop that as a tool. So I went on to work in the early days in 3D for video games and advertising a little bit. And I moved to London early 2000s. And I worked with Double Negative. I worked on 25 titles. And then 2-3 years ago, I decided to work on more independent production and trying to get the knowledge I acquired and the skills to offer that to more independent movies. So that's why I don't have anything to show, because anything from the big studio, from Deneg, or, you know, is not really the subject today. On independent movies, one of the things is that it takes a bit more time to get into the market. But if you want, I couldn't get the clearance for that, but you can go to see The Nice Guys, which is quite a big budget, but still is an independent movie. And for that one, we had to replace, to transform Los Angeles as it was during the 70s. And that was quite a big show. Originally from the script, Sean Blake, the director, wanted to have like 30 shots, VFX. We ended up with 400 shots. So.
Hi. My name is Michael Krummenacher. I'm a Swiss director living in Germany. I'm showing two films here in amazing Switzerland. One is Sibylle, that showed last night, and the other one is Heimatland, that will be shown on Friday. Yes, and I'm so impressed because I've never done a film with a monster or something. Like I love it, but I'm not the VFX guy actually, but maybe that's an interesting perspective. We can show trailer of Heimatland that has some VFX in it.
Tu penses qu'il fait jour ou nuit dehors?
C'est fini même s'il fait jour.
Moi, je veux plus jamais dormir.
As we intend the early door.
Aktuellen Informationen von SRF Meteo ist die gestern entdeckte Wolke nicht vom Ausland in die Schweiz gekommen, sondern hat sich in der Schweiz selbst gebildet. Bitte bewahren Sie Ruhe.
Unsere Berechnungen sind alarmierend. Diese Wolke breitet sich rapide aus.
Es geht uns gut! Wir haben Nein gesagt, wo sie sein Wellen unterfuckten! Was ist passiert? Uns geht's gut!
C'est le nuage de la honte. Parce qu'un jour, il faudrait payer. Peut-être ce jour est aujourd'hui.
Thanks a lot for all of this footage, and congratulations to everyone, really. Maybe I'll start with a question to the directors who are here. Independent filmmaking is quite difficult to get financed nowadays. And some of you have to, you know, invest a lot, you know, personally to those projects, considering that the, you know, the time to get the money back is quite long too. What makes you, you know, do that leap of faith, and is it a show reel you want to make and then be able to make bigger films, or is it really about the passion of doing that kind of stuff? Maybe we'll start with Talal.
I think it's more of an act of love and passion. With all story of love and passion gives you crazy things after that. So yeah, the idea was, I always loved monsters, as you know it. And I grew up watching these movies and whole 70s and 80s movies and the whole creatures in mostly American movies. So the thing was to give back that love by making this the horror and monster movie. So yeah, it's actually this is what gave me the leap of faith in a way. So yeah, what was your question exactly?
Do you see your present movie as a showreel that can allow you to get access to bigger projects?
Yeah, in a way, yeah, because it's really tough to make fantasy and genre movies without money, and you have to put the first brick, and then start to put the second brick. And this is some kind of a show reel in a way, but it's also an independent story, and the willing of telling something and to share it with people, share this love with people. But not only as a fanboy, because this doesn't bring you anywhere, but also as a storyteller and a way to tell a drama about character. So mixing drama and monster is what gave me that love. And of course, there are some references like Del Toro, for example, just to take the first who comes in my head. And yeah, this is.
I saw that, Victor, you're still in pre-production. Actually, you're doing a concept and you're selling it right now, right? Oh, and you could have, you know, I saw that Laura has worked for 5 years on a movie that cost 16,000. That's cool. But it would have been a lot more expensive if. But we'll.
It was 16,000. I have like my paper with the numbers here. It should have been almost $2,000, the production of Demonium, but we spent 16,666.
So you just said, well, let's do it, and we'll see. We'll take it, you know, the risk.
Yeah, it was kind of it started like a really small project. Started as a photo shoot, basically. Then was a short film that became Chapter One because we wanted to. That short film became kind of famous on YouTube, and they, because I wasn't there yet, they said, okay, let's keep writing more about this, and started to make a movie in chapters. We released 4 chapters, 1 per year in YouTube, and then the 5th was joined with the other 4 chapters. It's more than 1 hour film, and was taken out of YouTube, and you only could see the end of the story in festivals or like underground screenings we do in Argentina.
And did you think at one point that you would take the risk to not wait for the full financing of the film, or why do you wait for the full financing of the film?
I have to wait, but in the beginning I wrote this original story without really knowing if it would be live action or animation. And so I wrote this 20-minute long story, and I was very happy with it. And I thought, well, it's impossible to do it live action, and it will be very interesting to do it stop motion, because there are lots of sets, and there is a whole world. You know, it's an initiatory journey, so it's really interesting to build everything in stop motion. So I chose this technique. But it also involves VFX, because I really like the 3D printing technique for the heads, because you have to animate the expression and the faces on CG and then print them. So it's not just a motion, it's really it's really mixed with VFX. But yeah, it's very pricey, and so it's been like four years now since I wrote it, and I've been working on the financing. And the goal was to find co-producers who had the challenge to bring 2 million into 20 minutes. And this has been done before on other stop motion projects, but it's really, really difficult. So now it will be a feature film, because it's weird to say that, but to find 8 million for a feature film is much more easier than 2 million for a short film.
Okay, just in terms of budget, maybe I'll ask Michael a question. What kind of budget did you have for your film, and what kind of budget did you have for the few VFX shots you were talking about?
Oh. I'm not the producer. It was less than 2 million francs. Shooting in Switzerland is like really expensive. I mean, even without VFX. And I actually don't know the budget for the VFX. I don't know it. I don't know what we paid for the VFX.
And what was your investment, you know, personal investment? You know, how did you work? How did you collaborate with the guys from the VFX?
I mean, it was a very difficult project because there were 10 directors. Like, I'm one of those 10, and I was like some kind of artistic overall whatever. Because it is not a short film collection; it is interwoven with each other, and so it was really challenging. Like from the beginning, like developing the story took us forever. And first of all, it was pretty naturalistic. We were like, yeah, there's a storm coming to Switzerland, and we want to tell how the people react. And soon the question came. Yeah, how do we show it? Is it going to like, does the wind blow all the time or whatever? And so, yeah, we wanted to have that cloud. But I think sometimes it's a problem that we as directors are not used that much to use VFX. So we were very afraid to do that because When it looks like crap, it will destroy the movie, even if everything else is good. We just didn't have the experience. And we found some VFX guys in Zurich. Giordano Canova was the VFX supervisor, and he then collaborated with people from all over the world through the internet. There were people from Spain working on that cloud and so on. So, we tried to make it happen and to find a way how this is gonna look, because the film is shot in a very realistic way, like lots of handheld camera, available light and stuff. So we didn't want to make a genre film. I think it's some kind of political apocalypse movie or something, but.
Well, actually, there are two kinds of independent movies with visual effects. There are the ones made by directors who can do visual effects, and the ones made by directors who do their own visual effects, like Gareth Edwards did with Monsters. So when the directors... is there a director who can do their visual effects here? So I guess you... Okay. And Victor, of course, but I guess the other ones really depend on the VFX supervisors. So that's where you you appear.
Yes, I think one of the big problems we have is that it's called post-production, and everybody thinks that post-production comes at the end of the production.
Exactly what I wanted to talk about.
But the thing is, to be effective in terms of time and money, we need even to write thinking about VFX. So many times, you know, when I have to break down a script, I receive the script, I read the script, and, you know, it looks like Star Wars by 10, you know, because the writers have no idea. So we start to make the breakdown, we count the time, the price, and then it's completely over budget, it's not possible. So we have to go to the director, to speak with the director, the producer, and say, okay, we need to do something, you know. But very often it's too late. But if you have some ideas, and I think writers, directors should really try to take some time and to speak with supervisors from the start. So visual effects, we are here to help the vision of the director. It's not about creating crazy visual effect or anything. It's only to help make it quicker and to help where it cannot be done on camera. So if we have discussion from very early on, then you know we can help have a much smaller time in production, because very often this is what is very expensive, you know, the time that you will spend in production. But if you spend, let's say, 6 months or 10 months in pre-production, you have only 2-3 people working, it's really not as expensive as having a full team of people having in post to repair things which were not done properly because it was not thought properly at the start.
Yeah, I guess you have a few things to say about that. How do you work with the directors, you know, in pre-production and?
Bueno, yo hago efectos especiales físicos, o sea, lo que es todo maquillaje protésico.
Entonces, bueno, con el director habíamos trabajado justamente en el concepto de los demonios, que bueno, era justamente un concepto muy libre. Al hacer ultra independiente, no podíamos disponer del tiempo de la gente con la que trabajábamos, así que íbamos uniendo criterios a medida que iba avanzando la producción de Demonium. Las prótesis se iban reciclando una y otra vez al no disponer de presupuesto, así que teníamos que trabajar justamente al límite. Es demasiado guerrilla.
Well, it's clever. Maybe you have a few words to say about that, because your film, your latest film, works, you know, is based on an idea, on a visual idea. You know, the fact that they look alike, etc. So you had to plan the shoot in a very, very strict way. Can you?
Yeah, actually, now that I see more what this is about, I wish I'd shown the trailer for Los Parecidos, but I thought it was showing something that had to do with guerrilla VFX, that's why I showed nasty stuff. But yeah, as you said, Los Parecidos, the whole story is built on a visual idea, which is this concept that people suddenly start, their faces start becoming similar, 8 people in the bus station. So obviously we approached a lot of different roads in order to achieve this. I think what you were saying about having the time to read the script and talk to a supervisor, fortunately we did this, although all the pre-production was 2 months, just for this thing about the similar faces, we took like 8 months to plan this. So first we talked with a VFX supervisor who told us the idea to do this in digital, to just have the actor acting and take his face and put it in the other actors. But I really didn't want to do it this way, because this film is like a love letter to the science fiction of the 60s. It takes place in the 60s, it's in a bus station in the 60s. So if we suddenly do this in the 60s, like with a Hitchcock-esque kind of music, and we put digital faces, it was going to look like out of place. So we decided to do it all practical. So then we did some tests with the makeup department. We put some... we said, okay, let's do mask. So we put some mask on the actors. But then if you put a mask, you cannot move your face. The actor, you cannot read the expression in the actor's face. So then it was until then that we decided to do prosthetics. So what we did is that we made a cast out of the face of Ulysses, who's the character that they all become similar to. And then we put this cast into pieces, and we made a prosthetic of the forehead, prosthetic of the nose, the mouth, the cheeks. And then we put them all together. And then with makeup, we united all, and then we put a wig and the beard and the mustache. So it was like each actor had to go through a process of like 4.5 hours every day of the shoot. But in order to reach that result, it was like 8 months of test. And then in the end, the only thing that we did digitally was maybe when some shots you could maybe tell a little bit of the makeup, so digitally you fix it. But it was like a whole journey to get to that. And I guess the problem that I have working in the genre, and maybe other directors have it too, is that sometimes people tell me that I should be a novelist, that I should write novels, because I suddenly write a script about an infinite staircase and an infinite road, but I don't think about how I'm going to shoot it. I just have this story. Or then the similars, I just write this idea about people becoming similars. And then the producer tells me, did you ever think, how are we going to achieve this? Or you just wanted to write a crazy story and then see if you get the money for a film. And now that you have the money for a film, how are you actually going to do it? But I guess I like it. I like the challenge of thinking an idea and then having to find a way of doing it. I like that challenge.
Well, David Fincher would have gone for full CG.
I know he would.
So it's interesting what you said, because it feels like in independent movies, it tends to evolve more, you know, throughout the production. But maybe I will have a different point of view, because you worked on big productions and on independent productions.
Yes.
So, do you see a difference in the way the effects evolve throughout the production, the R&D stuff, and maybe, you know, some changes in the point of view?
Because the big facilities, you know, in London you have 4 or 5 really massive facilities, and there is a lot of in-house tools. So you have very big teams, and we have time, there is money from the studio, you know, to develop effects. But the principle is always the same. And many times the thing is that with an independent movie, we would say to the director, okay, this shoot, your camera is moving too much, so you have so much parallax. The only way to do it will have to build a CG environment. But if your camera move another way, you don't have the parallax, we can use matte paintings on different layers. And you know, we need to know a lot about camera and the technology on what we do on set, on what can be done. Personally, I always think that the more that we can do on set, always the better. And visual effects should be there only to help create what we cannot shoot.
Well, there is another thing. I spoke with quite a few VFX supervisors for big movies, and for instance, Phil Tippett told me that many, many times he saw directors that didn't know what they were doing in terms of VFX. So we'll see that in post.
Well, yes.
So that's the approach. And actually, they're asking for shots, and then when they have the fully rendered shot, they ask for something completely different, or the executive producer or the studio ask for... From my point of view, in the movies, you have to do it. And you can't do it, you know, 100 times because it costs money and you have to make a choice very fast. So I don't know if anyone of you has an opinion about that.
So it's always the problem, you know. If a studio says, okay, we can extend the time, we have the money to, you know, to do this shot as the director wants to have it, but not that many directors, even for big movies, have the final cut anyway. So the producer will say, okay, now you have to stop, you know, listen to these guys. But everybody has to make some kind of concessions, you know. And it's always trying to find the right way in terms of time and to stay in budget. But that's why also it's very tricky, because when we start to do the first bidding and everybody agrees and we say, okay, we'll do it this way, this will cut that much in that much time, we'll have to stick to that. So we have to be sure that if the director wants something completely different, then this is a new shot, and we have to do some extra work, and you know. But here the producers can come and say, okay, you know, we can accept to do it or not, or yeah.
Talal, maybe we'll talk about something. You had a practical creature on this film that will be almost completely replaced in CG.
Yeah.
And actually, we happened to show the trailer, the original trailer, the promo reel to Guillermo del Toro, and he couldn't understand why the practical was not the star of the film. So maybe you can explain the.
Well, I really wish that the practical effects were like 60 or 70% of the movie. We knew from the start that we couldn't do all the movie with practical, because the creature is flying, sometimes it opens its mouth, because in the movie the creature eats children, so the creature opened its mouth like that big, and you can do it in practical, but it's gonna be tough, and especially with our budget. I think the problem of this is a lack of inexperience. We started with the script, working with visual effects, with SFX and VFX, and the thing is that our practical creature was too ambitious from the start. And the thing is that we should have studied more the idea of what you can do with practical, how you can shot. Of course, all the shots are not possible with the creature, so that this is where digital interfere. And unfortunately, we in some shots it works, but in the global aspect of the movie, we're not happy of what the creature could do. So yeah, this is one of the greatest loss for me in that movie, because from the start I was arguing of this is how we should make visual effects, this is how we should make creatures, because you can't feel a creature if it's all digital, because it's all about physics also. You have to feel the weight of that creature when you're in the audience. So yeah.
It's very, I think most directors will always prefer to do things practical, and you can, I mean, There is the example of Fincher, which you just mentioned, that he would have done CGI, but I mean, up to the levels of someone like Christopher.
You can afford it.
Yeah, but someone like Christopher Nolan, who did the hallway scene in Inception with a real scene spinning, or now in his new film Dunkirk, that he's doing a plane falling, and he actually brought a plane from World War II
and crushed it.
But you have to be Christopher Nolan and have Warner Brothers up to bring you a plane and crushing it. I do understand that you look at movies like we're talking The Fly or The Thing, or you look at Aliens and you see how they build the aliens and how they were moving. And some people would argue that if you see it CGI, it's just not going to look as real. But then I also think, in the other hand, that as a director, you need to open yourself to what works best for your movie. And sometimes don't be afraid of new things, new technologies. And it happened to me in Los Parecidos that we built a whole stage of a bus station like in the 60s, and it's all built, it's all real, it's all practical. But then we need to do a shot outside when it's like the introduction shot, when it's like a huge thunderstorm, and it was very hard to do that practical. And I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to go digital. I wanted to do it practical. But then a VFX person showed me how, if with the budget we had, if he had done practical, it was only going to be like one corner of the bus station and just these drops of rain. And if we do digital, he can do like this huge bus station and raining outside. And it was until then I decided that for this project, for this budget, for that scene, it was better to go digital, because it was going to do more impressive, more like more rain, more, and I'm glad about this decision. But I was stubborn, and it took me like a year to be convinced. So I guess, as a director, you need to know there's no right way. It's not that it has to be always practical, always CGI. It's more the right thing for your project, depending on what you're going to do and on your budget.
Yeah, you have to know and understand your limitations. And actually, Talal had to recut many sequences from the film and make them more suggestive and more like the, you know, Jaws. And maybe Mikael can talk about that. Maybe you were talking about the fact that bad special effects could ruin an entire movie. So did you try to limit those VFX shots and do suggestions, maybe use one strong shot and that could prevent you from having 1,000 ones?
Yeah, man. The thing is that me too. I also like practical effects in any way better, or like to shoot the thing, but we couldn't shoot this cloud, and so we were talking about how is it possible, like you said, that we were talking to our VFX supervisor and we reduced that to some shots, and some of them I like pretty well, some of them I would do differently next time, because also the thing you said with less camera movement and stuff makes it cheaper and more affordable, but on the other hand it doesn't look too realistic sometimes. It looks good in the end, but it looks like compared to the rest of the movie that is pretty handheld and low light, it looks like now we're showing you the cloud, you know what I mean?
You can still have it handheld. It's about how you move it. It's all about the parallax, you know, so there are a lot of different ways you can test and you can do and still keep the identity of the movie. Yeah. I'm not speaking just about locked camera. That would be even cheaper and better, but you know, yeah. Mm-hmm. Because you know, I worked on Bourne Ultimatum with Green Grass, and he doesn't really know what is a locked camera. So, you know, yeah.
but I think that is a learning process, kind of. I mean, in for me as a director, because I was at film school, and there you learn kind of to work with the other departments automatically. You learn to write with another writer or whatever. But we, for example, we don't have a VFX class, so it's very hard to get people for a low budget, and so it's hard to get used to those kinds of processes. And also with, I think I would would have done with my other movies stuff differently if I have would have known about the options. Also with small things like set extension or I don't know, yeah. Instead of finding everything in reality.
You talked about realism, reality, etc. But there is actually a tyranny these days about having a perfect VFX shot every time. And you know, you can have many, many perfect VFX shots in movies like, you know, the Marvel super productions, etc. But many of them don't have a soul. And you can have in independent movies shots that are not perfect, but they have a personality and they have a texture and they have something to them that adds to the film. Maybe the three of you can talk about that because you worked on very short budgets or you worked with stop motion as a special effects. You chose stop motion as a special effects and you, all the three of you approached the effects, you know, and took advantage of the rubber quality of it and the texture of it, because in CGI, you know what they say, it looks real, but it's fake. You know, in practical effects, it looks fake, but it's real. It's
yeah, of course. You have VFX and techniques with bad mistakes and good mistakes, and when you have very well-crafted full CG movies, it's a shame because the good mistakes are not there anymore, and it's something that can give a soul to a movie. If you had those good mistakes, you know that something is not maybe 100% well done, but you can feel that it adds something to the project.
Goes back to Ray Harryhausen making his own, you know, creatures, and sometimes it's jerky, but it works because it has a personality.
Yeah, if you don't have these aspects, it's not interesting anymore. And in stop motion animation, for example, it's really about taste. But when I see a movie like Les Noces Funèbres, for example, I think that
Corpse Bride.
Yeah, Corpse Bride. I think that the animation is really too perfect. You don't see any mistakes, you know, and sometimes you wonder, am I watching CG or stop motion? And it's not as interesting as it could be because of that.
In Demonium, we always think and believe in whatever we can do on set is going to be on set. VFX are everywhere, but it's like a joint force. Mm-hmm. Both are going to the same way. For example, we had VFX apply to practical effects to delete maybe a mask that was broken or some like tiny little mistake in the moment they stick one latex face into someone. Well, we delete it in VFX, but we have like tons of VFX, and we try to look that movie as an 80s movie. It is an 80s sci-fi film, and in the 80s, the thing that we believe that made that movie so special was that you had the monsters there. You went to a museum and you can see the monster there. It's not like a zeros and one. You don't know, it doesn't exist.
Bueno, como decía ella, que los demonios se veían en forma física, que queda mucho mejor que hacerlos en CGI, ¿no? En CGI, y aparte, bueno, cuando tuvimos que hacer la nave, el chico que hizo los VFX de la nave estuvo 3 semanas para hacer el render en 2 computadoras, así que tampoco podíamos delegar tanto a la parte digital, porque era todo un problema de tiempos, y el tiempo es dinero.
And as we were a really low budget movie, and everyone there worked for free, and we just like get all our schedules
to use everyone's free time to do that. We have we had our own process, we have our own form of production and our own form of post-production. It's like he said, we have to rely as least as we could of VFX because we were few people who were into that because we were 300 people, but maybe we are 11, I think, or 13 in the VFX team. And I also did production and did VFX then, and we always do two things or three things in the movie, so we have to arrange everything to do that. So we couldn't spend that time in VFX. So everything that could go practical went practical. We blow out every explosion, you see that? We really explode a lot of things in the movie.
And actually, so you work, all over the world. So some in Switzerland, some in France, some in Argentina, some in Morocco, in Spain. Do you actually try to contact other independent filmmakers and ask for advice and share experiences? And is there some kind of, solidarity in this area or not?
Yes, definitely. People are really open to share their experience and to give advices. I've never met someone who was very defensive on his knowledge.
We work together.
Yeah. We know each other. We work together.
Yeah.
On what?
It's a project that wasn't done at the end, but Victor. Did a lot of drawings and advices on the art direction. He's a great visionary guy, really.
So from Mexico, what's your point of view?
I think filmmaking is teamwork, and making a film, I mean, you asked before if any director had done its own VFX. I'm sure at starting at your first short film, everybody did its own VFX, and I also, in my first short film, bought some ice and did my blood and stuff like this, but it's only when you are very early on. I would say that when you are making a film, you need to understand that making a film is the effort of a lot of people who are really talented in one specific area. It's a great DP, a great production designer, a great composer, a great VFX, special effects or VFX supervisor. So if you are one of those directors who wants to do everything by yourself, you're going to lose a lot of stuff, because directing is also listening. It's listening to your crew, to your team. And the same as making a film is a team, I think all filmmakers that we are sitting here, even if we don't know each other, filmmakers working within the genre, we are kind of a team in a way that, and that's something that happens a lot in festivals. Sometimes in festivals you meet someone and you say,
"That's my next subject."
How do you do this? And how much was this film? Or even not only about effects and production, but maybe also about what happens then. How was this sales agent? How was this distributor? Did it treat you well? Did it not? And I think it's very important to see us all as a team and work together to achieve results.
Yeah. So festivals is important. Festivals are important for all of you, I guess.
Well, yes. But the thing is that in the VFX, of course, everybody know each other, because we will work 6 months in one facility and then they will move on. What I think is